Michael in Lumberton, you're up next, listening on podcast.
Hey, guys. I have two questions. I understand if we only have time for one, though. The first one, or both of them, have to do with a friend that I made online who is sort of a traveling pastor with the Church of Christ. And he just sent me a message asking me about a question in a book that he read by Greg Littmer, I believe is how it's pronounced, called Catholicism Under the Microscope. Mm-hmm. And the question he had was talking about some canon law that apparently has been changed about the time that we should fast before receiving the Eucharist. And mm-hmm. at some point it was midnight, night before, then 3 hours before, and then now it's 1 hour before. And so his question is how, and also is that if we broke that fast, that it was a mortal sin. So the question is this, if it was a mortal sin in all those times, how does the church have the authority to change what's a sin? And also if whenever the canon law, if this is true, and if it, when the canon law stated that it was 3 hours and somebody waited only 2 hours, are they still in mortal sin, even though the law is now 1 hour?
Okay. In regard to the mortal sin question, I'm not aware of a source at previous times that was an official nature that established the gravity of this sin. Or the gravity of not observing the Eucharistic fast. I'm sure there are people who would have regarded it as being a mortal sin, but I can't think of an official document from that time that specified that. On the other hand, so let's suppose it was. Okay, let's look at an analogy with civil law, the kind of law that applies in society in general. Here in the United States, it is illegal to drive on the left side of the road, correct?
Yes.
But in England, it is illegal to drive on the right side of the road, right?
Yes.
And the reason is that in both situations, having a designated side on the side of the road for people to drive on avoids traffic accidents. And it could be gravely dangerous to human life to not have a rule like that. And in the United States, it would be gravely dangerous to drive on the left side of the road, whereas in the United Kingdom, it would be gravely dangerous to drive on the right side of the road. Now, you can imagine, though, the governments of one or both of these nations switching the side of the road that people are to drive on. And in that case, you could pose a kind of counter question and say, well, if it was gravely wrong to drive on this side of the road previously, why is it not gravely wrong to drive on it now? And the answer is because it's no longer posing the same danger. And so there are issues where civil law can specify how general moral principles are to be applied in particular cases. So in this case, there's the general moral principle of drive in a safe way, and by specifying how that is to be done, it creates an environment where the good of society is encouraged. And if you violate that rule, as long as that rule is in effect, then you're defying the civil authority, which is itself sinful. As long as what the civil authority is asking is legitimate, if you just defy it, then that is itself a sin per the teaching of St. Paul. But then if that rule changes, you have a different situation and you don't have to behave in the same way, and it's no longer a sin if they switch the side of the road that you're to drive on. Something similar applies with ecclesiastical authority. Jesus gave his church the power of the keys, and that includes the ability to make authoritative rules of conduct for the community of believers. Among those are ecclesiastical or church laws that specify broader moral principles, like how are we to show reverence or how are we to do penance. And if you violate those, you are violating, you're defying the authority that Christ gave to his church, and thus you're defying Christ's own authority because he's the source of it. And so if the church is determined we're going to have a particular discipline for fasting, or we're going to show our reverence for the Eucharist by fasting for a certain amount of time prior to receiving it, then that's backed by the authority of Christ. It may be variable in the same way that which side of the road we drive on is variable, But it's important that we respect the authority of Christ that he gave his church in making rules for the community of believers. And so if someone defies those blatantly, just uncaring, knowingly and deliberately defies them, then that's a sin and potentially a mortal sin against Jesus Christ himself. And that's the reason. It's not that there's some mandatory amount of fasting that's set by the laws of the universe that has to be observed, but we do need to have regulations for things like when it's appropriate to fast and how we're going to collectively show our reverence for Christ at Mass, and this is kind of a place where those things intersect. But because it's not a matter of natural law that we have to do it for a certain number of minutes, it's something that's subject to the authority of the keys that Christ gave his church.